Welcome to lecture number 8. In this lecture, you will learn everything about the heuristic miner or heuristic mining algorithm. This algorithm overcomes some of the limitations that we have seen for simple techniques like the alpha algorithm or learning the directly follows graph. Using heuristic mining, we can deal with, let's say, realistic real-life event logs. And at the same time, we are able to also discover concurrency, something which is impossible in the directly follows graph. So let's look at the outline of the lecture today. So this picture shows an overview, and it closely relates to the explanations in the previous lecture about dependency graphs and causal nets. So the heuristic mining approach first takes an event log and then converts an event log into a dependency graph. Once we have this dependency graph and using sliders, we can decide how many, let's say, connections to include. There is a second step, and in the second step, we learn the refined split and join behavior, and that results in a causal net. And such a causal net, as we have seen in the previous lecture, can be converted again to a PetriNet. And we can then visualize it either in terms of a PetriNet or a BPMN model or whatever notation you prefer. But let us first take a look of the heuristic miner in PROM so that you get a feeling of how this works in practice. I just started PROM and I loaded a semi-realistic event log of the purchase to pay process from SAP. So let's take a look at this log. It is not very large. So at the top you see the most frequent variants. The most frequent variant is happening 210 times. And as usual, we have this Pareto-like distribution, where at the bottom we see many, let's say, cases which are unique. So in total, there are 16,000 events and over 2,500 traces. The number of variants is close to 700. So these are some statistics, and let's take this log and run the heuristic miner based on this. So a starter plugin, interactive dataware heuristic miner, created by Felix Mannaert. And if you do that, you need to select the classifier. So what are the labels of the nodes, as in many mining algorithms. And when you open it, it immediately shows a CNET, and I could also immediately show the corresponding PetriNet. But let's not go so fast, and let's first look at the directly follows graph, which is an easy visualization that you already know very well. So here we set a threshold. And if we move the threshold up, we see, let's say, fewer activities and connections. And if we move it down, we see more. And so what you now see is you see all the activities and you see all the connections. And some of the connections that are shown are happening only one time. So move it up again. What you see is that the number of activities is changing. If I move up the slider, if I move it up all the way, everything disappears. And in this visualization, we only show the nodes that have connections that are above the frequency threshold. So now we have five directly follows relationships, all happening over 1200 times. If I move it up, you see that some are disappearing. Okay, let's go down to, for example, a more moderate level, and let's now look at the dependency graph. In the previous lecture, I explained what a dependency graph is. It is showing causalities. I did not explain yet how it is being computed. So we have a frequency threshold, and we also have a dependency threshold. And now, just for clarity, I first switch off the accepted connected setting just to look at the raw view. So if I now move up, we see again that if we move, let's move the dependency measure down. So now we have no dependency threshold and we only have a frequency threshold. And we can see this behavior that things are disappearing when they are very infrequent. Yeah, so this is this slider. The other slider that you see here is setting a threshold. Yeah, so now look at the diagram. You see that there are these dependency measures. How they are computed, I will show in a minute. So nothing is changing. But the moment that we get to higher values, you see that things are disappearing. And so now we only see arcs that have a dependency threshold of at least 0.943. And if I move it further up, I'm not sure that then in the end things will disappear, because no, nothing has a dependency threshold of at least one. So if I move it back down to a more moderate level, I'm now switching on firstly all tasks connected heuristic. If I switch on this, then we suddenly see all the activities. So when we select this setting, we include by default all activities, and we ensure that they are connected. So now you will also see connections that do not meet the threshold that we had before. Because, for example, the directly follows relationship, there are only 12 directly follows relationships above the threshold, but we see many more connections. And that is due to the all tasks connected. We see all the tasks, and every task has at least one ingoing arc and one outgoing arc. We just pick the best one if the threshold is not being met. The other one is the accepted connected heuristic. That is basically iteratively adding arcs for the activities that are selected until a certain fixed point is being realized. And so now we have these activities, and if I switch it on, nothing changes, because everything was already connected. But if I move up the slider, and if I now, let's move it a bit down, if I now play with this setting, you will see that here we just have two directly follows connections. If we select accepted connected, we make sure that all the activities that we have are connected. So we iteratively add activities and at least one ingoing and one outgoing connection until we have a connected network. So you get the feel, and so we can play with these different thresholds, and using these different thresholds, we may get, let's say, more or less connections. So at any point in time, when we have a dependency graph, we can also look at the causal net. Also the representation that I've explained before. So now we see all the activities that are included in the previous view, and we also see the bindings. This is in essence the same diagram, but extended with this binding information that we have there. Also for bindings, we will see that there is a threshold. This will be in the last part of this lecture. So if I move it down, we see more bindings. If I move it up, we will see that there are fewer and fewer bindings. So just look at the effect that I feel. If I move it down, we have these bindings. If I move it all the way up, we get fewer and fewer bindings. Probably I should play a bit with these other settings. So that you get a better feel, that if I play with this binding setting, I get either more bindings. And now we can see an example where you have many, let's say, bindings that are expressing the split and join behavior. Then we can, when we have a CNET, it can be translated into a PetriNet in a trivial way. So this is the corresponding PetriNet. You see that there are now many silent transitions, and these silent transitions are corresponding to the bindings that we were able to see here. So if I now go back to the PetriNet view and I move the threshold of bindings, then we will see fewer of these silent transitions. Note that now we can see all kinds of things that the alpha algorithm could never do. And so, for example, we are able to skip this first activity, create purchase requisition. And so you see several constructs that we could never see if we would be using let's say the alpha algorithm. And again, I can play with the various settings and I can get, let's say, simple models or more complicated models depending on the settings that we choose. And so just play yourself later a bit with this plugin. But I hope that this motivates you, that we have the ability to look at real SAP data and instantly create PetriNets describing the behavior that we are seeing. The demo in prompt that I just gave of the heuristic miner gives you an idea of how you can apply the heuristic mining algorithm in practice. What you could see is that these thresholds play a crucial role. I will explain how these thresholds are, let's say, formalized, how they are exactly defined. And we also saw very clearly when using the tool, we first learn a dependency graph, and only after fixing the dependency graph, we go to the level where we discover a CNET that can be converted into a PetriNet. So let's start by the learning of a dependency graph. I explained in the previous lecture what this is exactly. And as I just mentioned, this is the first step of two steps when applying heuristic mining. We first learn a dependency graph, then we learn the binding information, we get the causal net, and the causal net can be visualized as a PetriNet, as a BPMN model, as UML model, whatever flavor you like. So first we look at the dependency graph, which is basically a graph showing the causalities in the model. So please remember the notion of valid binding sequences that I explained in a lot of detail in the previous lecture. So this process model has one start activity, one end activity, and every activity has output bindings and input bindings. And in this example, the output bindings of A nicely complement the input bindings of E. I'm not going to repeat exactly the semantics. That's why in the previous lecture, I quite elaborately explained to you what is a CNET, what is a dependency graph, etc. So this is our goal. This is what we would like to discover. And if we look at a valid binding sequence that is highlighted here in red, and this corresponds, for example, to the execution A, D, C, E, where for A, we took an output binding which created two obligations, and E, for E, we took an input binding that is consuming two obligations generated by C and D. This is an example of an invalid binding sequence. So here we have a split, which means that we should do all three of them, but we never actually did B. So we consumed the obligations here, but here we created an obligation that was never done. So in the semantics of causal nets, we basically ignore these invalid binding sequences, and the semantics are only defined by the valid bindings. So throughout the entire lecture, I'm going to use this super simple example as a kind of a running example. So familiarize yourself a bit with this. So if I first look at the CNET, what kind of behavior it has, we can do A immediately followed by E. We can do, after A, we can choose this binding, which means that we do B and C in any order, and we end with E. And there is the possibility that we select A with this output binding. That means that we execute D one or more times. So D has two output bindings going to the end or going in through this loop. And after doing D at least once, but possibly also five times, we execute E. So now I look at a log that kind of corresponds to this model. So I have this event log, and I deliberately added a few traces, which are not possible according to this model. And so look, AE is possible, as I just explained. We can do A and then B and C in any order followed by E. So these are these 20 cases. And we can do A and then followed by at least one D or any number of these. In our event log, I deliberately added two, let's say, artificial outliers, where rather than doing both B and C, we just do B or we just do C. And so I hope that this is clear. So if we take this event log, that's why I'm the reason why I'm showing a concrete event log. If we take this event log and we apply the alpha algorithm that we have learned earlier, we just look at the directly follows relationships, etc. This is what we find. And everybody can see that this is very problematic. So D is disconnected. We cannot do AE. There is a place between A and E because of this directly follows relationship. But the PetriNet doesn't allow us to actually skip B and C and go to the end. So if we look at the traces and the problems that we have, find, then one problem is that D can be executed at any point in time. It's disconnected, so it could also happen before A or after E. C, B and C always need to be executed, while that is not the case in, let's say, like many of the trace variants that we see. So if we look at this model, only these 20 traces that we see here are possible according to this model. And this is showing the limitations of the alpha algorithm. So now we are going to look into heuristic mining that is addressing these types of problems. And we start by computing the dependency graph. So the dependency graph, as you could also see in the demo that I gave in the beginning, the dependency graph uses two thresholds. One is based on the directly follows relationship and simply counting how often one activity is followed by another activity. Here in mathematical terms, where a log is a multi-set of traces, I take the sum and then I count how many times a certain trace variant appears. Remember that L is a multiset. So this is the number of cases that has a trace sigma. And I multiply that by, in this trace, how often we see A directly followed by B. And we just have, let's say, a sliding window of size 2 that we move over the trace. And we could look, is at position I we see an A, and position I plus 1 we see a B. Looks perhaps complicated, but it's absolutely trivial. So we count this over the, not just a single trace, but all the cases in the event log, and then we get a number. So if we apply that to this event log, these are the numbers that come out if we apply this formula. And you can verify this very easily. So for example, if we look at how many times A is directly followed by E, then that only appears in this trace variant. That happens 5 times, and this is exactly this number. If we count how many times is A followed by B, right, we can take a look. It has happening 10 times here, and it is happening once here, which explains the 11, etc. So this is very simple, so we simply count how often something is followed by something else. When we were explaining the alpha algorithm, we looked at the footprint matrix, and in the footprint matrix we are not using frequencies. So we just have a threshold value. If it's 0, we say it's not possible. If it is non-zero, we say it is there. Yeah, so we were basically ignoring whether something is happening 1,000 times or only once. So that is one notion that we are using. We are also using, and this is called direct succession, we are also using another measure, which is called the dependency measure. And we need this measure because if things are happening in any order, we don't want them to be connected. If I always execute two activities, B and C, and this happens in any trace, and they are always just executed once, We do not want to have a loop involving B and C, because they happen both exactly once. They are just not ordered. And to address this situation, we use a dependency measure that should also be above a certain threshold. We also had the problem with loops, if you remember from the alpha algorithm. So if A is followed by itself, we have a special measure for that. So what does this say? If A and B are different, we take, let's say, the difference between how many times is A followed by B minus how many times is B followed by A, divided by the sum of these two numbers plus one. If there is a loop, so we are looking at A followed by A, then of course if we look at direct succession, we can detect that A is often followed by itself. We can count that. This is a second requirement to remove certain arcs. So if A is indeed in the loop, we should make sure that it doesn't get deleted. If I would just use the top formula and B is equal to A, then this formula would always yield the value of 0 and we would never be able to detect a loop. If A is happening, for example, 9 times, then A is 9 times followed by A, then we have 9 divided by 9 plus 1 is 0.9. And there we get the thresholds that you could also see in the tool. So these two conditions are in an AND relationship. So we set a threshold for the directly follows, the direct succession measure, and the dependency measure. So the first is a number, the other one is a value, let's say, typically between 0 and 1. Note that the top one can also be negative, but then we typically do not want to discard it anyway. We need to have both thresholds. Only if both thresholds are met, both values are above a certain value, we will not create an arc. The best way to explain it is by just using, let's say, number examples, so that you can familiarize yourself a bit with the things that we are trying to express. So suppose that we have an event log where we have 10 traces where A is followed by B. Then if we count this direct succession relationship, that is 10 times. In the reverse direction, it never happens. So we have there are no situations in the log where B was followed by A. Then we look at the dependency measure using this formula. Then we have 10 divided by 10 plus 0 plus 1 is 11. So here we have a positive number, here we have a negative number, because we have 0 minus 10, so 0 minus 10 divided by 0 plus 10 plus 1 is 11. So now we just keep the ones where both values are above a preset value. And suppose that, I don't know, we have a frequency threshold of 5 and a dependency measure threshold of 0.5, then both are in. This one would not be in because it would not meet any of the thresholds, and one needs to meet both. So this arc is included with these two statistics, directly follows and dependency. So here I'm just imagining certain thresholds. And it's vital that you see the practical relevance of this. When we are moving a slider, we are playing with this threshold. We can look at an XOR split. So again, I'm looking here at an artificial data set where I have 10 traces, where in 8 of these 10 traces we see A followed by B, and in 2 of these 10 traces we see A followed by C. So this is illustrated by the frequency count of these two activities here. These are then the numbers that we get. And so for example, A is followed by B is happening 8 times. If I look at the dependence, the other direction never happens. So this value is 8 divided by 9 because it's 8 minus 0 divided by 8 plus 0 plus 1 is 9, etc. So you can compute all of these values yourself. And now we set a threshold, and based on the threshold, let's say certain things are included or not. Note that for all of these, the directly follows relationship is equal to 0. And so only based on the threshold of that something should be followed at least once directly, all of these other ones would disappear. But note that these dependency relationships also have, let's say, higher positive values. So if we assume these two thresholds that we see here, these two arcs are included of all the possible arcs that have been enumerated here. And so we just kept these two. XOR join, very much the same. We can compute the numbers. We look at what are the values that are above a certain threshold. Then only these two have values where both the directly follows relationship and the dependency measure meet the threshold that is indicated here. So if we do that, these are the two connections that are included. Now we look at the more interesting scenario, because so far everything what I did was that the directly follows measure and the dependency measure kind of agreed, so there was no difference. Now I look at the following scenario, where I have 10 traces, described by this this process model fragment. We have 10 traces. In 5 traces, we see A, B, C. And in 5 traces, we see A, C, B. And so the ordering of B and C, in 50% we start with B, in 50% we start with C. But in all cases, we execute both B and C. Now it is crucial that you again look at these numbers. So if we would look at the directly follows relationship, we would include 4 relationships. So this one, this one, this one, and this one. However, if we look at the dependency measure, we will not include these, which have a value equal to 0. And so this is indicating the situation that I just sketched. There are 4 relationships that have, let's say, a frequency of at least 5. But if we look at these two, the relationship between B and C and B, the dependency relationship gives a value of 0, and that is below our threshold. So where does the 0 come from? Remember that the ordering of B and C in 50%, B is first, in 50%, C is first. So we get here, in this formula, we get 5 minus 5 divided by 5 plus 5 plus 1. And this is the same for, let's say, for both settings. So this is illustrating why we need to have the dependency relationship. If we would not have this, we would have a connection between B and C and a connection between C and B. So these are the arcs that we include, and we do not include any connections between B and C and C and B. And that is what we wanted to have. The end join part is, let's say, very similar. Again, we have an even distribution. And what we see again, that in principle, there would be 4 relationships. I should point at the right 4. There would be 4 relationships that would meet the directly follows threshold. But if we look at the dependency measure, we see that A followed by B and B followed by A, that these have a dependency measure equal to 0. Again, we find 5 minus 5 divided by 5 plus 5 plus 1 is 11. And so the values are 0 here. So these are the arcs that we keep. So an arc from A to C and from B to C. So this should be completely obvious. And again, the exclamation marks indicate the arcs that are removed because of the dependency relationship. And again, this is an illustration of the same phenomenon. So this is what we keep, meeting the threshold. Now, I would like to explain why we need to have the a special case for loops. So if we would apply the top formula with A is equal, where A and B are the same, so let's say that B is also A, then we would have A directly followed by A minus A directly followed by A would always yield a value of zero, so even if it would happen frequent. But we would like to discover also these loops. So if we would not have that, we would kind of basically destroy any relationship where one activity is following itself very often. So that's why we have this one, again with the constant 1, and it could also be a parameter. If, for example, like in this example, A is followed by A a certain amount of times, then we take this number divided by itself plus 1. So to explain this, so if A is followed by A and that happened 1,000 times, then we have 1,000 divided by 1,000 plus 1. That is very close to 1. If A never follows itself, then we get 0 divided, so we get a very low value. Now to get the exact numbers right, because now these frequencies of activities is not, let's say, very informative. So this could also correspond to the situation where A is followed by B is followed by C, and this happened 10 times. But we have this loop construct, and that is because in 3 cases no B is executed, in 4 cases 1 B is executed, and in 3 cases, B is executed twice. So in the last scenario, we do A, followed by B, followed by B, followed by C. So now you understand the exact behavior, and now let us take a look at the numbers. So, and I'm highlighting here the things on the diagonal in blue. A never follows itself, so that has this dependency measure of equal to 0. C also never follows itself, also has the dependency zero, measure of 0. Now we look at B followed by B, that is happening 3 times. And that's what we can see here. So we get 3 divided by 3 plus 1. So we are applying this formula. So now again, I could use this example and look at the thresholds. And the other connections that meet the thresholds are in essence the same as we have seen them before. So this is what is remaining for the example that I just showed. So again, take a careful look at this. So A followed by C is happening 3 times in the event log, and the dependency measure between A and C is 0.75. If we look at A followed by B, that is happening 7 times, because it's happening in ABC and ABBC. So in 7 out of 10 this is happening. This is the corresponding dependency measure. In principle, nothing new. The thing that is new is B following itself. That is happening 3 times. And if we look at the dependency measure, it is 0.75. Here I'm using this as thresholds, so these are the connections that are above the threshold. So let's go back to the example that I showed at the beginning as our running example, and now I can simply take this relationship and then also compute the dependency measures. So again, to test your understanding, compute this yourself. And so A, the dependency measure between A and B, then we look how many times is A followed by B, that's 11 times, minus the number of times that B is followed by A, 0 times. So we get 11 divided by 11 plus 0 plus 1 is 11 divided by 12. If you look at D followed by D, so we see that the directly follows relationship says 4. Then we look at the dependency measure. It is 4 divided by 4 plus 1 is 4 divided by 5. So this matrix is showing all the values that I just showing all the measures for all the different values, and it's simply applying the formula. So check this yourself that this is indeed correct. So here I have all the information. I have the dependency measures. I have counted how many times something is directly followed by something else. This is the formula, and if I highlight, for example, A followed by B, then the absolute count is 11 in one direction, 0 in the other direction. So we get 11 minus 0 divided by 11 plus 1, 11 plus 0 plus 1. Then we can take a look at this one. The directly follows relationship D followed by D is 4. So we do 4 divided by 4 plus 1 is this value. Now we can simply set a threshold. So if we require at least two direct successions and a dependency measure of at least 0.7, then these are the connections that remain. And note that the first number on all of these arcs is at least 2, and the second number on all of these arcs is at least 0.7. If we now increase the threshold, for example, we increase the direct succession threshold to 5, then this relationship would disappear. If we increase the dependency threshold to, for example, 0.9, then we see that also this connection would disappear. And this is exactly what is happening. And so I've set the threshold 5 for direct succession, 9 for the dependency measure, and then these 6 arcs are the ones that are remaining. And we see that these two highlighted here in red have disappeared in our resulting view. So how does this now work? So we set thresholds for the minimal number of direct successions. We count them. Then we compute the dependency measure. And we include in the graph only those connections that meet both thresholds. And please repeat what I just showed by hand. So here I'm showing you again the same plugin in Prom that I demoed at the beginning, but here using this very, let's say, small abstract event log so that you can verify the results. So here we see the directly follows graph and check that the numbers in the graph match the numbers in the table. Note that the slider is all the way down. If we now move the slider up, we are basically, let's say, removing connections. And if activities get disconnected, they also disappear from the graph in this particular plugin. So that was the directly follows graph that you have seen already in previous lectures. Then we look at the dependency graph, then we take into account two thresholds, a frequency threshold and a dependency threshold, and then we just include all the arcs that meet a certain threshold. So what you see, if we set the threshold to 2 and 0.7, then we expect to find this model, and you can see that the Prom plugin finds exactly that model, and that are the numbers are exactly the same as what I predicted them to be. If I increase the threshold, so I move the sliders up so that we have at least 5 direct successions and at least a dependency of 0.9, then you can see that, let's say, these two connections are dropping out. So we no longer see a connection between A and E, and we no longer see the self loop involving D. So if we have this view where we have the dependency graph, then in the prompt plugin you can learn automatically a CNET, a causal net. In a minute we will also talk in detail how we are computing that one. So we can compute a CNET, and a CNET can be converted trivial in terms of a PetriNet. Remember, I've showed this last time. So for example, for A, we have an output binding involving both C and B, and we can see that there is a corresponding end split here. If we look at E, E has three input bindings, and here we have an input binding that is synchronizing B and C. Nothing new. This is what I explained in the previous lecture. So here I was using the threshold where we could still go directly from A to E, as you can see by this transition in the middle, and where we could have a loop involving D, as is indicated by this network of silent transitions, which is ensuring that D occurs at least once, but could also occur multiple times before going to E. If I now increase the threshold, we will lose this connection and this connection, and this is then the corresponding CNET that we find. So we no longer see the loop involving D, and we no longer see the behavior of skipping the middle part and going directly from A to E. And here you can see the corresponding PetriNet, and it captures exactly this behavior. So this process model is filtering out, for example, the traces where we just do B or just do E, and is also filtering out the situation where A is directly followed by E. And that's also not allowed, but let's say the remaining traces are possible, the traces possible are the traces A, B, C, E, A, C, B, E, both happening 10 times. A, D, E is also a possibility, but the traces that are less frequent are no longer possible. In this situation, we can execute D only once. So these three traces are discarded, these five traces are discarded, and these two traces are discarded. So this should all be pretty obvious. We have been using sliders, of course, also looking at the inductive miner, at the directly follows miner, also at commercial tools like, for example, in Disco, in Solonis, and all of the other ones. We always have a slider. The model is either a directly follows graph or is a dependency graph. So Disco is using a dependency graph, but it's very difficult to see that, because it's only, let's say, removing connections if activities are actually overlapping in time. And so in Disco, the only way to remove, let's say, arcs between activities that are concurrent is that they actually overlap in time. So this is not so important. It is like an implementation detail in a specific tool. But some tools try to filter out arcs corresponding to causalities. Here you see the slider. So here we are including, let's say, a few of the activities, but all the paths. Here I'm, setting the threshold. So the slider here is working another way. If I move it down, I start focusing on the more frequent behavior. If I move it up, I include all behavior, so that corresponds to a low threshold. This may be a bit confusing for you. If we lower the threshold, the model gets more and more linear, more and more structured, while having the same set of activities. We could also play with the number of activities, and then the number of nodes would change. So I think this was pretty straightforward and pretty easy. Now we go to the next step of learning causal nets. So again, I have the overview. So we know now everything about creating such a dependency graph. Now in the second step, we would like to turn such a dependency graph into a causal net. And we would like to annotate the causal net also with frequencies, the same way we would see that in a directly follows graph. So again, it's a bit repetitive, but to make sure that the starting point is clear, given in log, we count the directly follows relationship, we count the dependency measure, things that meet the threshold are included, things that do not meet both thresholds get removed. What we want now, and that's what the topic that we are addressing now, is that such a dependency graph should be converted into a CNET, and the CNET should also not only show input and output bindings, it should also show frequencies. And here with the boxes, you can see the frequencies. So we should see splits and joins. We should see frequencies, and that's the target that we have. So using CNETs, what I explained in the previous lectures, we can also not just see pure XOR splits and splits. We can also see, let's say, inclusive ORs. An output binding may be any combination of outgoing arcs. So if we have A, and according to the dependency graph, A has four outgoing arcs, the number of possible bindings is basically any subset of any non-empty subset of these outgoing arcs. And one activity can have a combination of such bindings. And of course, the set of bindings should be such that we have at least one binding for every outgoing arc. So, long story, but what this is expressing here is that after A, we either do E, that is the top part, and apparently that happened 5 times, or after A, we do both B and C, and that is apparently happening 20 times, or after A, we do D, and that is happening 13 times. If we look at D, please remember that D has two input bindings, one coming from A and one coming from itself, and it has two output bindings, one going to E and one going back to itself. And these bindings are expressing that the input behavior of D is that it was preceded by A or by D, and the output choice is that it is going to do an E or it is going to do another D. And we can see that after every execution of D, that happened 17 times, 13 times we chose to go to E, so to exit the loop, and in 4 times we decided to go through this loop thing here. And you can see that these frequencies match exactly what we had seen in the log before. This is the join. This is very similar to the output bindings of activity A. They are kind of mirrored with the input bindings of E. So if we look at a possible path, just that you get used to that, we have two traces that two cases that follow the trace A, D, D, E. And if we follow that, then the different bindings and the frequencies are indicated here in red. And so when we executed D the first time, we decided to go through another round. Then when we execute D for the second time, we decide to go to the end. So now we know what the goal is, and now we need to identify. We already have the input and output arcs of every activity. We only need to decide, okay, what are now the bindings that we would like to include or not. So there are two approaches. The first one I will explain at some level of detail. The second one I will only give some pointers also to lectures in the future. So in the heuristic approach, we are using a time window. So we are looking at an activity and we would like to understand its split and join behavior. So we have heuristics where we look at the time window before an activity has happened and the time window after an activity has happened. And we look what are the activities happening in these time windows. And we use this information to create, let's say, input and output bindings. So this is an approach that can be implemented very efficiently. It's also easy to understand. A more sophisticated approach is using optimization. There you basically say, okay, we have different sets of bindings. Adding more bindings leads to a less precise model. So we would like to limit the number of bindings, but at the same time, we want to ensure that we can replay the traces. So we can convert that into an optimization problem, where we on the one hand try to replay the event logs as good as possible. So there is a certain penalty if there are traces that we cannot replay. And the more frequent the trace, the more severe the penalty is. At the same time, we want to limit the number of bindings in such a way that we can replay the log. And so in other words, with as few bindings as possible, we want to explain as much of the observed behavior as possible. And there again, you see that this algorithm is then playing on the trade-off between overfitting and underfitting, discussed in the previous lecture. So there are many ways, and with the dependency graph, I was very precise how that was computed. Here I will be a bit informal and I show you just one of many possible variations. So the basic idea of this first approach that I will explain in some level of detail is that each time we see the occurrence of an activity A in the log, we look at the window within the same case happening before this occurrence of activity A, and we look at, let's say, the set of events in the same case happening after the occurrence of A. So we have a window before the occurrence of A and a window after the occurrence of A. And we count how many times certain activities are happening within this window, and we do that for every occurrence of A. So here I'm showing a fragment of a log, and then you will see that this is very easy. We look at all the occurrences of A, no matter whether they are within the same case or in different cases. We simply look at every time we see an A in the event log. And then the A is always happening in the context of a particular case. We look at the four activities happening before A and the four activities happening after A. Of course, if we look at the initial activity, there is nothing there, but there are special, let's say, cases of handling with the beginning and the end of such a log. So here we look at the window before and the window after, and we simply count how often certain combinations are happening. And we only look at the preceding activities that are connected through these causal dependencies. And so here, there are also activities K, L, and G, etc. They are ignored. When we look at A, we are only interested in the window before in B and C. And in the window after A, we are only interested in D and E. I highlighted these relevant events in green. And if we now count and we look at the input bindings, we see that there are three A's that are preceded by just B, looking at the window of size 4. And there are two two occurrences of A in row 2 and row 5 that are preceded by C. So we had 5 occurrences, and these occurrences are split into 3 B bindings and 2 C bindings. We can also look at the output, and in this window we always see D and E. And so this binding has a frequency of 5. You now get the hang of it. And now you will see that's also very, very easy. And so we see 3 times input binding B, 2 times input binding C. So that is explaining the 2 here and the 3 here. And of course, on every arc, we create obligations and we remove obligations. So along an arc, these two numbers should be the same. After A, we always did B, both D and E. And so this binding has a frequency of 5. And again, you see that these numbers are matching. This is another example, but the idea is the same. We look at all the occurrences of A, we look at the window of size 4, and we look at what combinations are happening, both before A and after A. So here we see that we have one situation, one occurrence of A that was preceded just by B. Again, we are ignoring all the activities that are not having an input arc into A. So there is one occurrence of A preceded by just B. There are two occurrences, this one and this one, that are preceded by just C. And there are two occurrences of A that are preceded by both B and C. We can also look at the output. Take a look here. And we see that we either have D or we have a combination of D and E. And so, for example, if we look at D and E, that is happening the first occurrence, the third occurrence, and the fifth occurrence. Where we have an A followed by both D and E. So this is all easy, and we can again simply convert all of these numbers into bindings. Now, if we look at the input bindings, there are A has 3 input bindings. Just B is happening once. Just C is happening twice. B and C is happening twice. If you look at the output, we see that output binding consisting of just D happens twice. The output binding of both D and E is happening 3 times. So this is completely clear, and now just stop the video and try to do this yourself for this same setting. If you do that, it's more of the same. All the input bindings, so all the occurrences of A are preceded by both B and C. We are ignoring the activities that are not that are not the cause of A, are connected through an arc. The output bindings, we see that there are 2, one with frequency 2, the other with frequency 3. And then we can again annotate it, but it's very much the same as what we have seen before. So now you understand the basic heuristic, and you can understand where these numbers come from that you've seen before. Of course, there are lots of refinements possible. It could be that there are no corresponding activities, right? So what do you then do? We also need to carefully look at the beginning and the end that are handled in a special way. And you could see that in the prompt tool, is that we have a slider that is basically deciding, okay, what are now the bindings that are included? So there's a threshold there. If the same activity is happening multiple times in the time window, how do we handle that? Do we count that multiple times, or do we truncate the window, etc., etc.? These details are all out of scope. You have to realize that there are multiple design choices used to interpret the result. What I just sketched to you by using a window before and after the occurrence of A is basically a heuristic, right? Because we do not know how large should the window be. If we take it too large, we start including things that are at all not causally related. If we take it too short, we are missing, certain causalities that are there, but that are cut off because of the window size. So one of the, more elegant approaches, but from a practical point of view, often infeasible, is to translate this into an optimization problem where we want to minimize the number of bindings and at the same time explain as much behavior as possible. And there I'm relating to the previous lecture where we know that we can convert a causal net into a Petri net, and we can reason about traces that start with the token on the input place and end with the token on the final place. Such a trace is perfectly replayable if that is possible. And you can see that this is corresponding to an optimization problem. For every trace in the log, we want to find the closest trace through the model. Ideally, it can be done, let's say, perfectly. If there are deviations, there is a certain penalty. But at the same time, we also don't want to add too much bindings, because this adding lots of bindings would allow for any behavior, but the model would not say anything anymore. So this is an optimization problem, and to understand that this is an optimization problem that can be implemented fairly easily, but at the same time can be incredibly time consuming to execute that on real processes, I'm showing you this simple setting. So we have learned a dependency graph, and we have seen that A has inputs from B and C, and A has inputs from D and E. Now my question is, how many activities A are there? Well, if we look at activity A, how many possible activities? So an activity is described in terms of its input, not just its name, but also its input and output bindings. So we can compute, okay, how many bindings are there possible? So if we look at the input side, then there is an input binding just consisting of B, an input binding just consisting of C, and an input binding consisting of both B and C. So there are three possible input bindings, and we look at all subsets of the set of possible input bindings in such a way that all the arcs are being covered. And that's what you see here in green. Yeah, so this is the activity, the one that I'm pointing out now, corresponds to the A activity that has all three input bindings. If I look at the first one, that is corresponding to the A that is an AND join that has only one binding, one input from B, that would require both an A and a B as input. So this is corresponding to the A that is the AND join. This is corresponding to the A that is the XOR join, where we have two bindings, either one coming from B or one coming from C. These other ones are corresponding to inclusive OR join constructs. The same holds for the output. Due to symmetry, we can see it's exactly the same. So there are 5 times 5 is 25 possible A activities. But you can imagine, if the number of input and output arcs increases, this number will increase, let's say, very rapidly and may quickly become infeasible. But in principle, the number of A activities is finite. So if we now look at the process model and we have different choices for A, and we do the same for all other activities, we have a finite but possibly huge number of process models. And because we have a finite number of process models, we can try to replay the log on all of these finite number of process models, and we can take the best one. And the best one is the one that is able to replay as much behavior as possible while having the lowest amount of bindings, being as precise as possible within the given limits. So here we see the trade-offs that we have seen in the previous lecture, where we looked at fitness, often also called recall, precision, generalization, and simplicity. Often this will be too time consuming, so one can do, let's say, simple heuristics again based on this idea. You can use genetic algorithms, etc., etc. So there are different ways of handling this. In the beginning, I already demoed to you live the heuristic miner. Here I'm showing you two plugins at a very high speed. This is the classical version of the heuristic miner. In the PromLite version, you will not see this, but I'm just showing you this for historic reasons. This is a miner that is almost 20 years old. And there you have different thresholds that you can set, more than the ones that I just talked about. There are also these, let's say, improvements to make sure that the network is connected. And I'm showing you here this view, because here you can see the frequency distribution of the different bindings. That's something that you don't see as easily in the newer plugin. So you see input and output bindings and their frequency. And then whenever you have discovered the heuristic net, you can convert it to a PetriNet. So the CNET that we were having here, that you see here, corresponds to this PetriNet that you see here. So this is an older plugin. It is not so interactive and so nice as the newer one. So you can only use the newest one. Here I'm showing that you can convert it to BPMN or other notations. Here I'm showing you the plugin that I showed at the beginning. So there are these settings. You should now have a better idea of what these things mean. So we can, for example, if we here the bindings is moved all the way to the bottom. So we see that there are many bindings included. If we move it up, you will see that bindings will start disappearing. Using different thresholds, we get different models. And whenever we have a CNET, there is always a corresponding PetriNet, as you can see here. Here I'm zooming into a particular part, just to illustrate that there are certain constructs possible that would be impossible to discover if one would look at at, for example, the alpha algorithm. Look at that, whether you understand the bindings. So decide and complete has three output bindings, one going into this direction, one in this direction, and one in this direction. And you can see these three output bindings here. The end has two input bindings corresponding to these transitions. Here, all the silent transitions have just one input and one output. But if I would take, for example, this setting, and I would convert it to a PetriNet, I would see many transitions with multiple input and or output arcs. Here I'm applying it again to SAP data. I think the same data that I showed at the beginning. And you can see that, again, that the PetriNet is showing constructs that you could never discover in the alpha miner. For example, I can skip the first activity by taking this path. So the PetriNet explicitly shows you all the different bindings that are there, except for those cases where there is just it is not involved in some kind of choice. So I hope that this gave a good idea of the heuristic mining algorithm. This is an algorithm in contrast to the alpha algorithm, something that you can apply in a practical setting. So it's a very practical method. At the same time, it overcomes, let's say, the limitations of the directly follows graph, which is not able to discover concurrency, and you immediately get all kinds of loops that in reality are not loops. The heuristic mining algorithm also very nicely shows you the importance of these thresholds. So these thresholds, these sliders, are indicating what is the behavior that you want to see and what is the behavior that you do not want to see. I used before the metaphor of a geographic map. And by that I mean that if you look at the map of Germany, you may be interested to see all the roads and all the cities, but you may also only be interested in seeing the main cities and the main roads. And the slider functionality that you've seen in the context of for example, creating the dependency graph, is something that you will see in any process mining tool and any, let's say, usable technique to discover processes. So we are still in chapter 7, so we are now dealing with advanced discovery techniques. The heuristic miner is the first of these techniques. Next, we will also look at region-based discovery techniques, and we will look at the inductive miner, also from a practical point of view. The inductive miner is very important and has been implemented in several of the commercial tools.